Hello, this is Michael Gorin from Cumberland, Maryland. Today I'll be presenting a talk entitled Transperineal Prostate Biopsy, a New Standard of Care. Disclosures. Relevant to today's talk, I am a paid consultant for BK Medical. Corbin Clinical Resources, also known as Perineologic, maker of the Precision Point Transperineal Access System, and Coelus. For the last 30 years, the transrectal approach has been the standard of care for diagnosing prostate cancer. This procedure is performed by placing the probe in the rectum, and then alongside the probe, a biopsy needle is passed, where it then punctures the rectal mucosa and enters the prostate, where a core of tissue is obtained. The trouble with this approach is that because the biopsy needle must traverse the rectal mucosa on a trajectory to the prostate, it can take with it bacteria and so has a higher associated rate of infectious complications. By one estimate, the risk of an infectious complication related to a transrectal prostate biopsy is in the range of 5 to 7%. Roughly 1 to 3% of men who undergo this procedure will be hospitalized for sepsis. This is significant when we think about the sheer number of prostate biopsies that are performed each year in both the United States and Europe. It's estimated that 1.97 million biopsies are performed in the United States alone. When we think about how this translates to numbers in terms of infectious complications, roughly 100,000 to 137,000 men will develop an infectious complication each year from this procedure. In terms of sepsis, this translates to roughly 20 to 60,000 patients. So a significant number of men will suffer a complication as a result of this procedure. In particular, sepsis carries with it a tremendous cost to the healthcare system. These are data from a paper published by Michael Gross and co-workers at Weill Cornell. And looking at the largest series in the literature on the cost of urosepsis, they found that in year-adjusted dollars to 2019, that an average episode of sepsis could cost the healthcare system roughly $19,000. So there is, in fact, a cleaner approach to performing prostate biopsy. With transrectal, the biopsy needle punctures the rectal mucosa on its trajectory to the prostate. Instead, with the transperineal approach, the biopsy needle goes through the area of skin in the perineum, which could be sterilized prior to the procedure. We know that the transperineal approach to prostate biopsy is associated with a marked reduction in infectious complications compared to the transrectal approach. To date, there have been 7 randomized controlled trials comparing infectious complications between transrectal and transperineal prostate biopsy. In this meta-analysis published in the Journal of Urology this year, they found a roughly 50% reduction in the risk of all infectious complications when performing the transperineal approach. When specifically looking at sepsis, we have data from a number of different studies, not only randomized trials. These data come from 165 studies, including 163,000 patients who underwent either a transrectal or transperineal prostate biopsy. The rate with the transrectal approach is somewhere in the range of 0.8 to 1%. In contrast with the transperineal approach, this rate is roughly 10 times lower at only 0.1%. So because of these data, the American Urological Association recommends the transperineal approach as one option for reducing infectious complications associated with prostate biopsy. They stop short of saying that this is the preferred approach and offer performing targeted prophylaxis based on rectal cultures or administration of augmented antibiotics as an alternative to the transperineal approach. In contrast, the European Association of Urology does indeed go that extra step and says that transperineal prostate biopsy should be the first choice when performing prostate biopsy for men. If, however, it is not technically feasible or the urologist doesn't have access to transperineal prostate biopsy, then it is acceptable to perform the transrectal approach using some of the prophylactic measures that I discussed earlier that were made by the American Urological Association, such as targeted prophylaxis or augmented prophylaxis. Transperineal prostate biopsy should not only be the standard of care for its reduction in terms of infectious complications, but also because it does a superior job detecting anterior tumors. In this study published in European Urology by Schouten and co-workers, they looked at patients who underwent an MRI-targeted transrectal prostate biopsy and looked to see where was cancers detected on the MRI-targeted portion. They found that roughly 40% of all prostate cancers that were diagnosed were found in the anterior aspect of the gland. In contrast, when looking at just the templated cores for this biopsy. They found that roughly 80% of all missed cancers, meaning cancers that were missed on systematic biopsy but found on MRI-targeted biopsy, were found in the anterior aspect of the gland. So these data suggest that the transrectal approach, where one approaches the prostate from its posterior aspect, is simply limited in detecting cancers in the anterior aspect of the gland. One would hypothesize that the transperineal approach is better at detecting these cancers because the prostate is approached from its apex. This hypothesis has been borne out in a handful of studies. First study that I'll share with you today by Baer and co-workers, patients underwent both a transperineal and a transrectal fusion biopsy, and there was a comparison between the rates of cancer detection between the two groups. There was roughly a 15% improvement in the detection of all-grade cancer using the transperineal approach, and this was mostly due to the detection of clinically significant cancers in these patients. In another study by Pepe and co-workers, these authors went ahead and performed a saturation prostate biopsy as well as a transrectal fusion biopsy and a transperineal prostate biopsy on patients. The saturation component of the biopsy served as the reference standard to which the results of the transrectal and transperineal prostate biopsy were compared. Similar to the prior study that I had showed you, a higher proportion of biopsies performed with the transperineal approach were found to have clinically significant prostate cancer. There was a sensitivity of 93% versus only 67% with the transperineal approach as compared to the transrectal approach. Interestingly, when you dive down deeper into the data and look to see where are the gains in prostate cancer diagnosis being made, it happens to be in those anteriorly located tumors. Here with the transperineal approach, there was a 94% sensitivity for diagnosing anteriorly located tumors. In contrast with the transrectal approach, it was limited to only 25%. Data from my own group when I was formerly at Johns Hopkins confirms this as well. We looked at the rate of transperineal prostate biopsy leading to grade group 2 or higher upgrading among men with low-risk prostate cancer on active surveillance. And we found that using the transrectal approach, only 19% of tumors that were upgraded were found in the anterior aspect of the gland, whereas in contrast, 44% of tumors were located in the anterior aspect of the gland using the transperineal approach. These numbers become further apart when looking specifically at upgrading to grade group 3 or higher prostate cancer. So what are the different methods for performing transperineal prostate biopsy? Well, there are two basic methods, and the first is performed with what's known as a grid stepper unit. It's a mechanical unit so that the user does not have to hold the ultrasound probe in their hands, but rather it is mounted to the grid stepper. The user is then able to control the rotation of the ultrasound probe and it going in and out of the rectum. Mounted to the stepper unit is also a grid plate. The grid plate is pressed against the perineum, and the user is presented with a gridded needle guide on the ultrasound. This was the preferred approach for performing transperineal prostate biopsy for, I'd say, approximately the last decade. There are, however, limitations to this approach, and that is the need for either general or spinal anesthesia in order to perform prostate biopsies using a grid stepper unit. And the reason for this is because one uses a grid plate, you have to anesthetize a fairly large area when performing this procedure. An average grid plate measures roughly 8 by 8 centimeters, and simply this area of skin and the underlying tissue is just far too large to anesthetize with local anesthesia. To address this issue, urologists started performing what's known as the freehand-based approach to transperineal prostate biopsy. With this approach, rather than using a grid stepper unit, the urologist holds the ultrasound probe in their hand and then makes a puncture on either side of the perineal raphe using an access trocar. Through this common access trocar, the biopsy needle is then passed repeatedly and steered under ultrasound guidance towards the prostate, where then biopsies can be performed. And it's because use of this common access cannula is limited to such a small area of the perineum that this procedure can be performed without issue under local anesthesia. To reinforce this point, here's a diagram demonstrating this. Again, you could see the large area of skin that must be anesthetized for use with a grid. In contrast, relatively smaller areas need to be anesthetized when performing the freehand-based approach. One challenge with the freehand-based approach, however, is the fact that in many descriptions, the access cannula is not tethered to the ultrasound probe. So the urologist must rotate the ultrasound probe rather continuously throughout this procedure in order to track the location of the biopsy needle. Oftentimes, the biopsy needle is not visualized for parts of this procedure, and it takes a rather long time to perform this when you have to search for your needle tip throughout the case. This has been overcome with a device known as the Precision Point Transperineal Access System, which was invented by my partner, Dr. Matthew Alloway, in Cumberland, Maryland, and is currently sold by Perineal Logic. The Precision Point device is comprised of three components. It's a single-use disposable device. The first component is the rail clamp subassembly, which is attached to the probe. Then you have a needle carriage with five aperture holes that goes on top of these rails. Through any one of these needle holes, you then place an access trocar, and this access trocar is now tethered to the ultrasound probe so that the biopsy needle is now maintained within alignment with the arrays of the ultrasound probe. Here's just some images of the device in use. You can see it's mounted to the ultrasound probe. The access trocar is going through the needle carriage and is engaged into the perineal skin, where it then serves as a common access point for performing these biopsies. So only the small area of skin needs to be anesthetized. And here you can see the ultrasound display, a very nice image of the entire length of the needle being visualized, entering the prostate, and you could see it both in the sagittal and the axial views. So key to being able to perform this procedure under local anesthesia is being able to perform a good local block. The block that we most commonly perform in our practice is what's known as the periapical triangle block. It's called this because what you're essentially anesthetizing is a triangular column of tissue bounded by the levator ani muscle, the rhabdosphincter, and the external sphincter of the rectum. One numbs all the tissue extending from the puncture site at the skin all the way to the apex of the gland. Once at the apex of the gland, you puncture underneath the endopelvic fascia and inject the lidocaine between the apex of the gland and the endopelvic fascia, and this numbs the prostate itself. Here's just a schematic representation of what one sees on the ultrasound view. Here in the sagittal plane, we could see the pubic arch. You could see the levator ani muscle draping over the apex of the prostate. Here's the rectum, the external sphincter muscle, and then the prostate itself. A spinal needle is passed under ultrasound guidance, and lidocaine is deposited in the soft tissues apical to the levator ani muscle. Lidocaine is then deposited in the levator ani muscle itself. And then the needle is punctured beneath the endopelvic fascia, and lidocaine is deposited in that potential space between the fascia and the prostate. And with this, we have found that this procedure could be routinely performed under local anesthesia. This has been documented in the literature. Here, not using the Precision Point device, but rather the original freehand description. Stefanova and co-workers published these data in the Journal of Urology in 2019. They measured visual analog pain scores for 511 patients undergoing this procedure, and they found pain scores well under 3 with probe insertion, skin infiltration, periprostatic infiltration, and then the biopsy itself. So very reasonable and tolerable pain scores. We have found the same in our local practice using the Precision Point device. Here we show the visual analog scores for pre-biopsy and post-biopsy, and then the worst pain experienced by the patient undergoing the procedure. And we observed a median pain score of under 2 out of 10 when performing this procedure. So in conclusion, transrectal prostate biopsy is a tried and true method for diagnosing prostate cancer. It's been used for the last 3 decades or more. However, this approach is associated with a significant risk of infectious complications. Transperineal prostate biopsy reduces the risk of infectious complications by avoiding the rectum altogether. Methods now exist to safely and comfortably perform transperineal prostate biopsy under local anesthesia in the outpatient setting. Additionally, studies have shown excellent cancer detection rates with the transperineal approach, and these cancer detection rates may likely be superior to the transrectal approach. So based on both the infection avoidance benefits of the transperineal approach, as well as the cancer detection benefits, I believe that this method should be the new standard of care in place of transrectal prostate biopsy.